pleasure to welcome Christophe Cozier, who's a very dear friend and somebody who is a seminal person working in the Caribbean, in Trinidad, as a curator, artist, activist, director of Alicia, which some of you will be familiar with. I think Aisha mentioned it earlier. So just to say, Chris is an artist, writer, and curator, and was a recipient of the Prince Class Fund Award in 2013, and as I said, is co-director of Alicia. I'm just going to, it is a long, very long list of a biography which you have access to, so I'm just going to give you the highlights. So the highlights are he's on the editorial team of Small Acts as a curator, the Caribbean Journal of Criticism, and has been on an editorial advisor for the Bond magazine for the Americas in the early 2000s. He's also co-curated projects, including Paramaribo Span in Suriname in 2010, and Wrestling with the Image, Caribbean Interventions, the Museum of the Americas in 2011. As a curatorial advisor for the site Santa Fe in 2014, he continues to advise on the Out of Place project at Alice Yard in 2016, and that's ongoing as part of the project, and I'm hoping Chris will also tell us a little bit more about that. Artist residencies include Cannonball Art Resident Artist, Miami in 2015, and Rising Waters 2 for the Rauschenberg Foundation Residency at the Captiva Island, Florida in 2016. He's included, his artworks are included in many exhibitions, many international exhibitions, including the Havana Biennales in both 5 and 7, Infinite Island in the Brooklyn Museum, Afro-Modern Journeys Through the Black Atlantic at Tate Liverpool in 2010, the Global Africa Project Museum of Design, Art of Design in New York, and currently there's the recent one, which is the Relational Undercurrents, Contemporary Art of the Caribbean Archipelago, which was at NOLA in Los Angeles in 2017, and is about to open in 2018 in New York. So, yeah, this is the, so Cozier's one-person exhibition in development opened in the David Krupp Project in New York in 2013. And he is currently participating in the public program I'm Not Who You Think I Am in Berlin Biennale in 2018, which is the way in which we were able to get him to come over here to actually encourage him to make a journey from a very busy schedule in Berlin to join us. So just to welcome Chris to London and to the conference. Thank you.
Everyone can hear me? Yes. Let me get close up. Okay, yeah, I just want to thank Roshini and everyone for inviting me here. I'm trying to follow this conversation and trying to figure out what and how I can contribute to I'm going to dwell. I have like two agendas, so Roshini, why don't you tell me, I'd say, 25 minutes, because I think it would be nice to hear what you'll have to say, so I want to take up mostly a lot of time by speaking. And on the agenda is, I was asked to talk a little bit about my own practice, what I'm thinking of now, in the context of the conversations that you all are having. And also talk a little bit about Alicia and what is the relationship between those two things. And then I'm just going to share that I'm starting with a very peculiar image, it's not peculiar in England, but this image and many like it have been coming up to my room over the last couple of months. And I thought it would be a good marker to begin today's conversation because, I'm assuming most people of care being in England know that that's one of those moments in cricket, right? I call it the appeal. you know, everybody would go, ah, you know, and, but of course, I was talking to people in Germany, and in Germany, this is a completely odd image, you know, like, what the hell is this image? And why does it have a significance to me, and why I've been collecting images like this over the last couple of months? Because when I was a kid, growing up, listening to cricket commentary, I never understood the difference between the word umpire and empire. So for a long time, until I got a little older, I really thought these men were appealing to the empire. I realized, oh shit, it's umpire. And I learned that a little later in life when my dad sent me to cricket school. To Harvard's clinic. I love the word clinic for cricket school. Of course, I was a complete failure. But if you guys, there's an American program where they interview artists, and it's called Real Bad at Sports. But I think that typifies my relationship to cricket. My father's disappointment. I became an artist instead. So anyhow, what really interests me about the image, it also, to throw us into today's conversation, I think it also kind of defines something about the difference of generations in the curriculum as well. Because I think so much of a way of how cricket is narrated from the era of people like C.R. James and so on has to do with this relationship to England and towards prevailing at this game that. And it suddenly occurred to me, as someone who's born in 1959, Trinidad becoming an independent nation state in 62, and a republic in 77. And the game of cricket is pitched across a wider net now. You know, we're playing against India, Pakistan, Australia, even South Africa now that they've become an independent country of sorts. And so this kind of relationship to empire isn't quite the same, especially in the context of where we live geographically, so close to the United States. So it means, in some sense, this sort of canonical relationship, even in terms of how you think about yourself in relation to the world, that binary is not really so much part of our reality. And it's not surprising so much so that the contest within the Caribbean between the contemporary players with the rise of the IPL and, you know, and all that kind of thing, because the old cricket clubs were caught up in that sort of relationship of mastering this game to contend with England, while the new game is being played in a different context. So, and to some degree, in terms of my own practice, I thought it would be interesting, like, what were the things that drove me as a young person growing up in the Caribbean. So I want to share four clips, just very quickly before I jump into my own. This is a piece by an artist called John Stormeyer. It was produced in 1981, and it was called The Caribbean Basin. And it talks about the Reagan Initiative, and just using a simple vernacular, you know, it can't hold water. And the holes in the basin were Cuba, Nicaragua, and Grenada at that time. The piece disappeared. It's never really discussed in wider conversations about visual and conceptual production and political awareness in Latin America, because we're always somewhere sort of after the end, but never between the commas in Latin American conversations. Or American or hemispheric conversations, and the sense that there would be conceptual practices in the Caribbean in the early 80s just never factored in the imaginations on either side of the fence. But these were the works that I saw when I was younger and thinking about going to art school. I found this work because it showed it was not thought of, very little was written about it, and it disappeared. And when I returned to the Caribbean after art school in the United States in the 80s, I sought the artist and I got the piece up and asked him to show it again. And when he showed it to me, he stuffed the whole of Grenada and the whole of that was Nicaragua with chula, because he said, of course, that's what the American genetic gives when he lies, he hands out chula. So, you know, the piece has a kind of life, it has a kind of an awareness. And what also struck me about this piece is that in interviewing the artist, I asked him, well, where did this come from? Well, at the time, he was part of a Rastafarian cult and had a vision. So that brings up another question about where does Rastafarianism fit within a certain kind of consciousness within the broader Caribbean and internationally? Because normally, within the conversations with Jamaica, it sits within a kind of intuitive conversation and more within the music, but never within a conceptual practice in terms of how it proliferated beyond Jamaica. This is another, and something else is really interesting to me at the time. This is another work produced in the same work by a Trinidadian artist called Anna Serrao, a sculptor, studied at the SLE in the same period, in the 80s. And what she was very interested in is our conceptualization of land and space. So she made board out of compressed newsprint, newspaper. And then she made a thing called mortar and pestle, in which she placed stratified rock in boxes made of compressed newspaper, counterbalancing the relationship between geological time and, we can say, human time as defined by newspaper. And setting up a whole discourse about our awareness of the context within which we live. So I'm kind of going through these works. And of course, I want to play a couple of other games. One of my private little obsessions. I only discovered the narrative of art as we understand it within the confines of the Caribbean and beyond. Like, that whole obsession with intuitive or the kind of endomandry thing and so on. But actually, I think this would have been my first kind of idea as a teenager growing up in the Caribbean as to what was Caribbean art. Right, and to me this is a very iconic image. You know, it's a last Daniel Hartman drawing. It, have you ever seen it in an art book coming out in the Caribbean? No, it's on every t-shirt, every album, and everybody had that posted in their house. And if you've seen the heart, they come. When I saw it as a child growing up in the Caribbean, the scene on the train tracks when Ras Daniel Hartman appears to the guy running away from Kingston, the whole cinema was because, of course, this represents an iconic figure and an iconic conversation in that sort of social moment. This drawing of the factors. Why? I don't know. Another thing, so I'm just throwing it into my mental landscape in 1981-82 when I was leaving the Caribbean to go off to art school. And strangely enough, this still remains like relatively obscure information. So when people ask me, well, why do you make the work that you do, and then what are the things I'm looking at? This is an artwork by a woman called Wendy Nanan, and what it talks about is the relationship between Creole culture and Hindu culture within the confines of Trinidad. There's a village called Ladini in the Pastora where there is a black Madonna, and people argue as to whether this Madonna is Kali or whether it's a Madonna. And she did this series of papier-mâché constructions in which it's a wedding between the Madonna and Krishna. And it's that moment when the garland is handed over and the woman looks pretty shocked as she discovers he has that third arm and he's got a pretty nasty expression on his face. And it's talking about the class dynamics and the whole kind of history, because if you understand anything about the Southern Caribbean, you understand it's less a conversation about white hegemony and blackness and more about how do people from an Afro-Creole background share cultural space with an Indian, a population of Indian origin, dominantly Hindu. So in that landscape, I venture forth. I was also very interested in carnival practices. Following on from that conversation, the previous work, a lot of artists of that early generation living in the Caribbean were very interested in not so much in representing carnival, but using the methodologies of carnival, the material practices, to make contemporary, to talk about other things. So they won't put to the, you could say, the technology of carnival, but not in the carnival space. I'm making a shift to a practitioner, Peter Mitchell, who actually studied in England, returned to the Caribbean, and actually engaged the carnival very, very directly. This piece, which happened in around 1981, brought up quite a number of concerns for a lot of young people, because it brought up the question about the possibility of performative actions and works, you know, happening. Performative works and objects also having, and I wrote an essay in the early 90s about objects and actions having the same sort of agency within the social and public space. And it would throw us back into the 19th century to ask ourselves something about how our artistic narratives came into being. Because very often when one thinks in the sort of Western canonical, the Euro-American canonical conversation, we place performance and the origin of performance within the Cabaret Voltaire and things like that. But in the context of the Caribbean, and specifically in Trinidad, we have to go back to the 1860s with the Cavalier riots and the early street processions of the Janet Carnivals, of course, in the 1860s, which younger curators like Claire Tanhons and so on have taken up and taken quite far. And in fact, there was something quite interesting when Trinidadian artist Marlon Griffin, along with Hugh Locke and others, did a performance where they pushed down, they opened the gates of the tape and crossed the bridge to enter. And that had a very particular significance in this context because, of course, Tate and Lyle, you know, the tint, and, you know, what is the strength through sweetness or some weird joke, you know, as the, you know, I mean, the estate is in Cuba, and a lot of the conversations around carnival come from the transported populations around the enterprise of ship. So, in a way, all of these words speak towards a future and towards a past. They encapsulate something about, you know, our experience and provide a kind of platform for a wider discussion. So it means, to some degree, we're not exclusively tethered to some of the narratives that, you know, one encounters here to find a way forward. And of course, I left the Caribbean and went to the US. And in the US, with that platform, I was naturally drawn to the early development work of people like David Hammond or Boyce and things like that. So to just jump right on in, I mean, when I first came back into the Caribbean, I really wasn't that interested in making things anymore after spending all that time in art school studying painting and whatnot. And this is one of the first objects I made, which was a pair of glasses, talking about the burglar bars on middle class houses and talking about people's lack of confidence in the state and the kind of consumer practices that we live in. Since like in the early 90s. And this, if you've ever been into those kinds of spaces, you'll see the decorative burglar bars. It's not limited to the Caribbean, of course. And so I kind of worked with crafts people and conceptualized these objects. And I also continued to investigate the performative. And I did one performance that caused quite a bit of conversation that interested me at the time, which is I decided to have a conversation with a sheer trap. A sheer trap is a kind of object made out of soup material that politicians in that era wore. You know, that kind of Mandarin Africa kind of conversation. It looks like a suit, it's made out of blue blazer material, but it's got military epaulets and pockets. And of course, no shades of tie. And in the 70s, one of our politicians was refused entry to parliament because he tried to enter with one of those things, not a suit. And I was a teenager at the time, was very impressed by that. I had a suit like, so I'm actually talking to my own suit that was made for me in 1976. My mom was about to donate it, and I decided, you know, I'll keep it. And, but of course, it couldn't fit me anymore. I'd grown up. And I kind of asked the suit questions So I was kind of thinking about some of the things that Vito Akanshi had done, and I was thinking about our own carnival kind of stage. So what I did is I put out an ad in the newspaper around 1991, 92, and I said, meet me in this location, I'm going to talk to a soup. Of course, people thought I was crazy. And they came, and I had nothing to say to the soup. Because, of course, in the Caribbean, it's assumed that we all have petty lyrics, and we can make flowery speeches and so on. And I had nothing prepared, and I'm very anxious about performativity, you know, because I, you know, I'm an artist, I'm not really a performer. So I just, what I eventually did is I kind of analyzed the suit to a, in front of an audience, and like asked it, like, do you want to have the cake and eat it too? You know, if you have epaulets, you can like shape, the material you use reminds me of Prince Philip, so it's like, you want to have the cake and eat it too? But what was really interesting about the whole enterprise is someone tapped me on the shoulder, and I thought they were doing it to say, you know, even a ball, you know, you brought this out to the house here and you just mumbled it. And actually said, no, we want to talk to the suit too. And that really opened a kind of fascinating conversation for me about this latent, this kind of inherent desire to be performative. And basically, I had to stand to one side and different people lined up and speak to the suit. And they spoke about masculine hegemony, the politician, and things like that. This led to a number of other experiments. I won't spend too much time here. I did a couple of video pieces, and one piece that showed in the Havana Bay in 1994 was called Blue Soap, and it had to do with me bathing myself in blue soap and working with a number of friends, talking about the whipping of children in the primary school system, and the relationship between power, the building of the state, and so I made labels for bars of blue soap, and sneaked into the supermarkets and left them there. I don't know who took them. And you know, if people got it, I never knew. Those are very hard to come by. That one I found in Germany recently, so I was lucky to get a photo of it. That's just a still from the video, a multi-channel video I did around 1994. And then there were kind of experimental pieces like this during the 90s, discussing one's relationship with the state, who's included, who's excluded. And this is one piece that I've actually put a lot of circulation because the way in which it was read put me in a lot of trouble. But it actually, you know, because of course, you know, gay friends of mine thought, oh my God, you're setting us up, you know? And then other friends of mine were saying like, yeah, man, we're wrong with you, we understand. I said, no, 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 I'm not sizzler, okay? Get it right, there's irony involved in this work. But it actually initiated a really wonderful conversation between myself and the filmmaker from Canada, Richard Farr. Because this piece sort of came up in evidence where people were applying for refugee status in Canada based on our laws, which are now being repealed if you follow the news because of Jason Jones. But in this early period, the discussion was on, now starting up. And so Richard sought me out because he wanted to know why was I interested in this topic. For me, it had to do with citizenship and belonging and how the state kind of disowns people and how singular the notion is of you know, the ideal citizen. But of course, it can be interpreted in much wider ways as well. I also experimented a lot with music and I did a number of pieces, songwriters. I won't spend too much time on that. This piece is a kind of strange piece to me. It was a piece I did in Denmark in the early 2000s, so I'll just skip the whole 90s and come here. And the only reason I'm showing it is that for the biennial, the curators were very intrigued by the line and to think you had been believing this work that time or this time. And they wanted to use it in some of the things with Viagra. And it was really interesting to me because it's a piece from the early 2000s, and this is just a page from a notebook. But the notebook will come up in later during my conversations because I, even though I drifted very far away in performance and video in the 90s, I started drawing a lot. And it wasn't until the mid-2000s that a curator visited my studio and we were talking about a project, and then he just snatched up a drawing book and said, you know what, I just want to show one of these drawing books. And that really freaked me out because I never anticipated anybody seeing the drawing books. It was a very private kind of enterprise, and the minute it had to be shown, it became performative. And then I became very self-conscious. I couldn't even write in my own drawing, my sketchbooks anymore, because it took on this whole kind of import that was alien to my process. And I think my abandonment of painting in my own practice had a lot to do with what painting implies in that kind of grand historical canonical conversation, in the sense that, you know, the myth is that the painting, you know, is something you declare for the millennium in some kind of weird way, while drawing remains something speculative, tentative, investigative, and also ephemeral, because it's like money, it's like a piece of paper, it's like a document that can disappear as fast as it appears. You know, especially in our kind of climate, you know, mildew, insects, you know, the weather, you know. So I became really interested in how I can articulate a thought, and commensurate with thought, there's a kind of sense of the fleeting ephemera. And, you know, so I really became very committed to working on paper as an act of kind of a counter narrative to the grand narrative, you know. And so this project, I won't spend too much time, was a kind of public project that I did in Copenhagen in 2002, in which I fenced off all the benches in the park just as the spring was coming. And people had to apply for forms to get into the area where the benches were, which was very annoying, of course. And I would give them a visa stamp for. And the visa stamp was a plantation owner. I'll jump right ahead. Around this time, I was working with two images from my history books growing up, and one image that I invented myself. So in my, the narrative was winner takes all, which is the plantation owner presiding over land and territory. Heading north, which is the runaway poster from you know, the era of slavery. And then this one that I made up myself, which is, and he was such a polite boy. And many times you would have a little Swiss or Costa Rican flag sticking out his back, which is the politician running off. And I kind of used to do these narratives of islands in which it would, these narrative islands in which, you know, I would say, okay, for every 100 people going north, there's one or two older men and three or four politicians running. You know, because as in most small islands, you know, 50% of the deposits are controlled by 2% of the depositors, and, you know, so you get a sense of the social landscape, right? So, so the form I gave, if you were lucky and you became an owner man, which is what I call it, you got a number and you got a key, and you could go and in the park and sit on the bench and build. And one of my favorite parts of this project, which will come up later, and why I'm sharing it, is that I also fenced off a podium and left it in the park. And that's where the line, I think you have been reading this all this time, because what happened is, if the podium implied the auction block in slavery, of course, it also implied the athletes in Mexico in 1968, and it also implies first, second, and third world narratives, the sense of competing and prevailing. And somebody has to win and lose. And my sense of it is, if I fence it off, then it starts to talk about one's relationship to institutions and whether one should fight to break down the barricade to kind of enter into that game, or whether if you are locked out, then you're free to embark on a narrative of your own choosing. So, you know, so I'm kind of thinking about that Hegelian construction of history and trying to, you know, work my way along. I'm going to make a strange segue into my engagement. So, how did Alicia as a project start? Well, it started with myself, a writer, Nicholas Dockin, and Sean Lennon, an architect. Not really over the space. I just wanted to do things in the space in the public domain. And Sean had the space, and we decided, you know, we would allow them to do so. And then, of course, many other artists and designers gravitated to the space, and then we found ourselves having to roll up our sleeves to their interests and their needs. So it became a kind of default setting to build a kind of discourse or conversation around contemporary practice in Ponsby. And it came as a follow-up from another grand idea where we found ourselves building and raising money to do a big, big kind of complex. And this is typical in these kinds of situations, which interacted with organizations in England, in Glasgow, in Nevada, but it was like we were told, like, you've got to buy this suit to come to the board. So we bought the suit, and then we had no money to buy drinks, you know? And so the whole thing collapsed because that model needs to be understood. So Cozier is a kind of space that has no expenses, really. The only expense is the activity, you know, and the commitment is to kind of do projects that may or may not work, that may or may not fail, and then if the idea is worked out, it can be carried forward into larger, more better funded or other kinds of spaces. But there's a double agenda in which we're also trying to make our space a space where things can take place and happen. So after sharing one or two projects, like this was a project from, but again, more recent project by Tirso Mata from CUSA, and it was called Silent Witness, and when we made a weird link between the gun culture and potty trading. And yeah, it was very, very funny, but bizarre. Or this very interesting piece by a very young artist in Trinidad, where scholarship boys and baby bottles, talking about the education system. So, you know, there's a kind of platform where all these young artists are responding to a lot of these activities. And we are providing the kind of conversation that allows them to kind of experiment in this way, as opposed to pressuring them into kind of commercial forms of production. This is one of my favorite for a project. Actually, Blue Curry is here. I think I saw Richard Rollins, I don't know if he's still here, and I had run off. But for the 10th anniversary of Alistair, we started a project called Out of Place. And what we did is we reached out to our network and we told artists, Blue and myself, that you give us the instructions and we'll make the work. And the idea was to kind of question traditional notions of authorship, investigate collaborative enterprises, and most of these projects were done out in the social space. And like this was one of the fun projects where a young artist just wanted to balance three petroleum, you know, drums and one pallet in an empty lot. But it kind of talks about consumerism and import, you know, or economies. And it's kind of nice to see a photograph in the context of the right, the high rises going up as the traditional architecture is destroyed. So it's talking about, you know, high rise and consumer culture and so on. But it's very informal. It's just arranged or dropped down in an empty lot, and until a vagrant moves it or the owner of the property gets annoyed and says, put that there. So a lot of the gestures in the project were kind of done informally based on instructions. I also want to talk about our interaction we've had with other networks, and I'm very interested in an artist from Suriname called Marcel Pinas, and he is also involved with his communities. He's a Maroon, he comes from the Njuga heritage, and that is in the northeastern districts of Suriname. And he's gotten access to a whole abandoned Alcoa or Alcan station, which he's turned into a kind of art park. And he's working with his community to talk about presence. So a lot of his pieces are very grand, and because he would get like the whole village to assist him in making wood. So So it's a different way of articulating the presence of a community through the hands and the fingers of everyone who makes things. And so I've done a couple of projects with him, and I'm really excited by this enterprise of building a community. And it sits, and you know, very close to Brazil. And there's a kind of way in which the Guyanas don't factor again, just like the rest of the Caribbean, in many Latin American conversations. And so I've actually started a project with a group of curators in Colombia and Mexico, you know, about the position of Guyana within the South American and by extension, a site which is a link between the Caribbean and Latin America. So you'll see where that goes. Just a kind of a project I was working on with Marcel. So this is just going through some of the projects we've done at the yard. Shot in Kingston, very, very tricky title. It was a show I did about digital photography in Kingston. Because I think there's a burst of photography in the region now because we access to digital cameras, a lot of young artists access to computers and so on. Where photography has really become quite common. So I did a survey of contemporary Jamaican photographers. And he showed me that very informative. This was another project I did called the Performative App, where I've become very interested in. You can see the follow on to my origins, where I'm interested in performance and the document of performance. And what is the relationship between the two? This artist always makes me laugh, James Cooper from Bermuda. He takes walks on the beach and just uses blue tape and tapes it to these helmets, motorcycle helmets, and he calls them, like, I don't know, there's a weird name for them, temporary sculptures. You know, where he takes a photo and that's it. And I like that kind of intuitive response. I love that one, time box. You know, whatever he finds on the beach, he just sticks it in the air and photographs. This one is a kind of interesting one about monumentality. This was a young artist from Suriname, Dirad Ransomote. He wore this major suit out of patchcloth, and he called it the Caribbean Man. Then he came to Trinidad and had to photograph him in different spots. But I always like this photograph simply because it's shot in Lord Harris Square in Port of Spain. And Lord Harris has a very interesting history. He was one of the governors in the 19th century. He was not a very good one, and he got into trouble because he spiked this woman, which is what Nyquan's story, Lost in El Dorado, covers. This bad behaved woman, he suspended her, there was a baby, they put you on a spike. And he also, I think, was known for doing sort of weird things militarily, get people killed. Battle of Trafalgar, or not one of those battles. Can't remember which one, not Trafalgar, one of the battles, you know. But he has a strange history in the sense that, as we know, he's not on his pedestal anymore. The reason being, in 1970, when we had a revolution, schoolgirls poured a tin of black paint on him and made him black. And he stayed like that for many years until the government, sometime in the early 90s, decided they were going to repair it and repair him back white. And then one night in the 90s, a group of drag queens were having a ball, and one decided, there's a popular song at the time, I think it's the same time, called Donkey, where you jump on somebody's neck and wind on their shoulder. So a drag queen jumped on his shoulders in the middle of the night, and he fell and broke. And then, like, drug hustlers and, you know, like, drug addicts and so on, took his parts and tried to sell it to China and smelt it. Right. somehow the museum were able to intercept and get that his part. But then it's just a wonderful this happened long before, you know, all the takedowns of monuments, you know, like he was organically by the shifting political circumstances. Because I know right now they're struggling with Barbados, because Barbados had Trafalgar Square before even London. And now they want to chase Lord Harris, not Lord Harris, that's Harris, right? So, Nelson, sorry. Yeah, so good. So I thought it very interesting to have an empty space and for Duraj to do his performance standing where Lord Harris once stood. So we did a number of experimental projects with the performative movement, like Charles Campbell of Jamaica, Ebony Patterson. The first set of coffins were actually done in Alicia, and then they reappeared in the Armas project by Claire Cancon years later. She made a coffin for everyone that was shot for the time she was spending in Trinidad. It was the young men she took to her in different parts of the city. And then on the night she had done all of them, she invited people, and then people were asked to carry the coffins to the Bristol district, of course, which was very disturbing to a lot of people who were having drinks and partying to see people carrying the coffins. It caused quite a lot of chaos. The mayor came to tell us to stop the threatening some shots. And then I have another ongoing project called Proximities, and that deals with like societies close to us that are dealing with the same issues and showing the new works from those contexts. So this was one of the first proximities, and I showed mostly videos from the sort of Spanish-speaking Caribbean and Latin America, particularly Central America, where people are discussing. And I always like this piece. It was called Ways of Making Love in the U.S. by a young Mexican film video artist. And what she's doing is she's calling out all the spicy food she ever ate. And then the men keep changing. So of course it's playing on this notion of the Latin woman and what she represents, and then of course this devouring of men. And so a lot of the pieces, and this one was Ivan Monforte making himself cry listening to a very, very sad Mexican song. And which was really ridiculous. And then of course many eventually gets that tear to fall. Sean Leonardo runs into the frame and grabs it. It brings up a lot of ironics, and I was very interested in the kind of performativity. Glenda Leon was scribbling a $100 bill and then using a coca leaf to smut all the ink. Yeah, so there's a lot of experimentation, and I think it's interesting to show these works in the context, of course, maybe to a lot of young artists, because you never know what that will encourage them to do in the future, or how they will think about their own practices and so on, and builds a relationship between our context and other contexts. How long? Okay, so done. And I'm going to close off. Yeah, there's blue in the arranging combs. So this was all part of the anniversary project, the Culture Place project. My favorite blue project in Point Spain was the Blue Curry Special, where we made these signs with one of the popular sign painters in Point Spain, and we gave it to different vendors, and they had to invent a Blue Curry Special. So this is a guy that sells seal codes, and if you went to him and asked for a Blue Curry Special, he would make it. Blue can attest to this, and then he went to retrieve the sign. The guy said, no, leave it another week, I'm very good business. a really interesting relationship between artists and the public and the public space. The irony is that this was a scope on Stella outside the National Museum, which was even funny. But that's a Bukhari special. That's mine. I kept one of the signs. This is one by a British artist, Al Graffin, who spent some time with us, and what he did is he made note of all of the writings on the taxis. On the back of the taxis, the guys always have these inscriptions, so he wrote them down. So as part of the Out of Place project, we installed it in one of our Alexiad spaces. We have two spaces. One is a kind of warehouse thing where artists work, the other one is a kind of a space where people can stay and expand. Another project from Kellyanne Lindo from Jamaica. She is what you call a barrel child. Her parents left her in Jamaica with an older relative when she was young. So she wanted to talk about her relationship to her parents through the things that come in the barrel. And then we kind of converted the barrel into like a kind of a tunnel through which distance. and of course working with other artists, using Photoshop and a network of designers and artists that hang around the art world into a kind of photographic series. I'm not going to spend too much time. I want to talk a little bit more about my process, and so you can see a relationship. I mean, I look at the newspaper a lot. So, I mean, I like, always like this photo. This is a politician leaving a meeting after he got into trouble. And he's got that no comment, smoke on his face. And I didn't know, I had that photo in my studio for years. And then, like, one day I just knew what to do with it. Because he looked as if he's saying, like, once I have bread and meals, I'm good to go. And that song is just like a line from a 70s movie. And I grew up watching a lot of these movies. And my favorite was Tony Falcon series from Philippines. He was like the Philippines James Bond or something. And so I said, okay, I started doing these drawings, and then I said, okay, once you have bread and wheels, you're good to go. And then I had a whole series where I had loads of bread and wheels and maps and talking about kind of global economy and how money moves. I even had pimped out wheels. And I kind of slow down a little bit here before I kind of come out of what I'm working on. So, all of this subconsciousness about drawing, I decided sometime in the late 2000s, to mid to late 2000s, to just commit to drawing again. And I decided to do drawings that I knew people would see, but they were the same size as my movie. And I had this idea that these drawings, I would rinse out a lot of things that were being said about my work. That there's something weird about, you can be in your studio making work and people are writing and talking to you about it. And then, and I found that there was a heavy ideological reading coming in around my practice. That's a funny thing to say. It's just very academic, very ideological. And I wasn't really being, and there wasn't much of a discussion about the experience of the encounter, the, you know, what nuances, separate from imagery, just the visual language of the things, how I was putting things together. So I was trying to dodge that discussion. I'm trying to, like, I'm interested in aesthetics too, you know, as well. And can a fluid wheel artist be interested, excuse the terms of the word, be interested in aesthetics? Am I decadent? Am I responsible? Does every work about I make have to be, you know? So I embarked upon this series called the Tropical Night series, where I was just doing, it started with a few drawings, it turned into 400 drawings. And I was very interested in the kind of phenomenological encounter of these works when they were in store. And the poetics of putting one thing next to another, right? And I've been talking to certain writers who talked about, made connections between this work and contrapuntal relationships and call and response, and things like that, which is becoming interesting to me. It's a whole side branch of my practice. And at the same time, while I'm doing this work, I still venture out or back into things that. And this is an image from this series that is kind of haunted me, because it's the most reproduced image from the series. And it talks about being afloat, adrift, between states, between land, between narratives. And it talks a little bit about visibility, because it's the most reproduced work of mine, but it's never mentioned. It's part of a series of 400 drawings. So these are the challenges you have with visibility and the conditions of visibility. Than your artist, in terms of how it looks sequence and how it is narrative. For those of you who may have grown up in parts of the Caribbean, that's the cover of the Nelson Medium, if you know the Grapes of Knowledge, Cutridge, and how we entered into language. So I won't spend too much time, except this was the take, the Bakugan version of it. It's never the same when it's shown. That's been a big issue. Every time I show this series, I use a different arrangement. There are 400 drawings in all, but I only show about 200 at any given time. It has a topicality and a fluidity to it. So each context decides what the configuration will be. And the narrative is I've had some really interesting conversations at Stirling. Like, I knew when I was doing it at the Brooklyn Museum. The curator was interested, yes, and the conservators, but the best conversations I had had with that piece were with the cleaners and the maintenance guys walking by, because they, most of them come from the Caribbean anyhow, and they would just jump in and say, no, that can't go next to that. That makes sense. So I was standing back and saying, wow, that's really cool, because they've understood this vocabulary. I don't want to romanticize that point, but it was really interesting, their sense of ownership and what could go next to what, to say what. And that opened a really interesting idea to me about how this body of work could develop and what is the ultimate context of it to be shown. I always like this one, as a door peeing in the four corners of the frame. So they just put up the paper clips and arrange accordingly. And there are narratives embedded in them about contemporary history. In a lot of my work in the conversations, I try to avoid probably kind of dipped into vocabularies in the 19th century one or two times. I've actually tried as hard as possible to make the vocabulary of my work very contemporary. To talk about the space that I grew up in the Caribbean, which is in the 60s and 70s. And so, in a way, it makes my work somewhat unhinged, because very, very often there's a lot of mining of the 19th century to kind of logically make the Caribbean visible in institutional spaces. And in my own practice, I've really tried to duck that. It's made my work somewhat unreadable because of how research practices work. Like, what is this book about? And I'll give you a classic example. Like this recent series of men, which is the Gasmen. This piece started in Chicago, and I was thinking a lot about me growing up watching kung fu movies and cowboy movies and shit. And I was walking on Lake Michigan, and I suddenly thought I was on a beach in the Caribbean, because of the colors and the light and so on. Except when there was a block of ice flying by, and then I realized, no, I'm not there. And then I had this idea to do this kind of kung fu movie scenario. Yeah, where is it? Yeah. So I tried to work with the drama department, and the art department was a disaster. And I ended up just getting two guys working in the office. I gave them gas bombs and took them onto the beach, and they all started to become convoys and lasso guys, and I can share a little. How much time do I have? I'm going to show you that, and I'll close with one where my head is now, and then that's it. So, sorry, I got a little complex thing to escape this. Sorry, I think it's about very snacks. So, just to give you a narrative, I know the volume is going to lose. Wait, but what's going on? So basically, what I did is I shot it, took the raw footage back to Trinidad, and then got young musicians to look at it. Like Bollywood style, and they compose music to the raw footage, which I then edited out. And I kind of like this kind of place, that's this of work. And about the kind of from local resources and the oil narrative. And also, it's suddenly clear to me that just as these multinationals are moving around the planet fighting over resources, I'm an artist moving in a kind of corner. And a kind of piece, this is coming in around my practice as well. I mean, like, what is the irony of all that in terms of, international agencies funding me out here? It's really a kind of interesting irony. And what is the space for reflection on that thing? So I did two videos. I'll show you both of them. The other one is more obvious, I think. So what was going on there? Before it pays off. So what's really going on with that project was, this slide is very misleading, because what's going on with it is that the screen of the other one is actually distorted, because when I was a kid growing up, I could only go to see those B-movie masculine spectacles. It didn't shoot the seats, which are right down front. So I actually distorted the screen to replicate that effect of being right up front, to talk about my relationship to the B-movie kind of male spectacle. But the way it's shot, it looks as if the screen that's normal is distorted, and the one in the back, it's actually projected with a distortion, to match that effect of being up front, like the cinema seats used to call the pit when I was a teenager. Again, I've returned to drawing, and the whole thing goes along with a series of drawings where I'm drawing these kinds of insects. And insects are made of text, and the text is kind of libelous stuff. It's a kind of a rant. But the irony of things being put down in black and white and then becoming illegible. Because the things I'm saying are potentially libelous. And it's talking about the entanglements with oil and the way that when you see insects that bite or sting, they're often slithering away, they're leaving the frame. And so there's a whole kind of series of these drawings that I've been doing over the last couple of years, and it's connected to the oil narrative. And I've started a whole series of investigations. These are the silicone bit heads that drill, and they look like snakes. And I had this whole thing about Laocoon and the myth, the gift from the Greeks, which is oil, and the relationship between violence and oil economies, and the entanglements of it. So this is this series. And it's turned into a series of light box installations that I did in Art Basel at the Betsy Hotel. And then I'm going to stop. So there are two projects that are current. This one, which is the one that was in LA and it's in New York now, where I'm very interested in, like, this notion of being a fluid has come back. And I can share this video with you just for a short while. I'm thinking about sort of what's a book or it's not that. Probably I'm just going to shoot. So I've built this installation out of cardboard. And it's talking about rising water levels and people being afloat. And I'm trying to make sense of that now, because there's a lot of conversation about that, but I didn't realize that this notion of being a flute has always been in my work. So I'm kind of investigating that through these kinetic sculptures. It's an ongoing project. And the latest project, this is where I'm going to end my presentation, I kind of visited row house projects in Houston. And while I was there, I met this guy called Kenny Lee. His project is called Design for Social Intervention. And he was making a very intriguing proposal about the relationship of artists to this new trend called social practice. And he was provocatively suggesting, well, you know, you're an aesthetician, like you make things, right? You kind of make form and thing is your business, right? Form and ideas. So why should you sacrifice that to do social work? This is a provocative question. He says social workers do what they do, they're very good at it. You know, they understand the community, they have a long relationship, it's a sustainable relationship. So why don't you work with a social worker? And but because they're looking for new creative solutions and you are looking for new audiences or new ways that you can find to make your work interesting or to develop your work. So instead of abandoning your practice, hold on to it, but with a community. So I said, okay, that's an interesting challenge, I'll take it up. So they're working in Worcester, in the Dudley Uplands area, and I went to work with them, and it was kind of strange, because there was all of these concepts of how to mobilize this migrant community, struggling between social services and gentrification. And every idea I came up with was thrown out. They just said, no, that can't work, the community doesn't like it, the property owners don't like it, the funding organization don't like it. And I was just throwing out ideas and it was working. And it was such a weird thing, because this is the first time there was such an immediate accountability, you know, around work, right? You know, and that one day I got really frustrated and I just took and I built a red step, which had been in my book all along, and took it and dropped it down in an empty lot. And people started coming up to him and saying, hey, that was just a step from my mother's house in Ghana, from Cape Verde, from Jamaica. Of course, Trinidad, I knew that red step. And that red step has its origin in chapel housing, you know, where the houses move in the step state. And then people from the Dominican Republic were like, oh yeah, and after the hurricane, all that was left was the steps. And a whole conversation came up about the step as a portal, like in that City American program, study. So, like, it's like the place you leave and the place you never quite get back to in terms of ideas of home. So I decided I would design a poster with instructions on how to make one and send it to different people in different locations. And what eventually transpired was that this is it in Boston. I went to Colombia, they made one in Colombia. This is one in Jamaica. So different people are making it. And back to Boston. I left it in Aliciad and some young rapper came and did a video on topic. So, you know, so it's, so I'm doing, so they're building a step in Split in Croatia, which is where I'm going at bike on the weekend. And in each location, I'm interacting with people. Colombia, they did a really interesting, so I'm gonna end my presentation with a little bit of the Colombian thing and the most recent video I've produced. Because I think I'm in a kind of conversation about history and memory. This is an old piece of colonial architecture that was abandoned on the street of Port Bay. And I did a video trying to move it, but it was impossible to move. The mortar of that era is like really heavy. But I want to just share with you the Colombian video, because in Colombia, I tried to do it, they wouldn't let me do it, so we had to pay a card guy. They wanted to move it from Septima in Bogota downtown to the School of Architecture, which had been demolished. So I think I'm going to close off my presentation with that video and then a bit. Because I'm just really having a lot of fun working on this project. So I don't know what's going to happen in the episode. There's a lens gap between for me. I don't know what the narratives are there. And then you get the control for you. And then, you know, thanks a lot. Thank you.
Thanks very much. It was really enjoyable. I learned a lot. And I'd like to ask you just one thing about your drawing. So when you show a lot of drawing, the color one, did you reprint them or they are all the original one? They all be the same size?
There's some repetition, of course, in terms of the imagery, but each drawing is an original drawing.
So you put them together.
Sorry.
So you put them together as a whole, so many of them?
Yeah, what I do actually, the installation process is very simple. I grid out the wall, I put all the paper clips up, and then I sit there and try to figure out this one, that one, that goes. And my kind of dream for the series is to actually let the public decide what the order should be. But each time I make that arrangement with an institution, the problem is people will be touching it, how to stop people from stealing it. And then, of course, from a conservatory's point of view, once it's set, you know, they don't want to move. And so I'm trying to make deals both with the Tate and with the Brooklyn Museum. But okay, we put it in one time. But what if we want to change it? Let's say the show is up for 6 months, we changed it 3 times. You know, maybe I come with a writer, a friend, or a random member of the public, and they make a new arrangement. And everybody temporarily agreed, and then once it was installed, we didn't let anybody touch it. So it's an ongoing. So the other question is maybe I should make a fascicle, a book, like a pack of cards, like tarot cards. Mm-hmm. And then, but then the problem is then how do we discern the original from the prints? In the same institution, oh my God, what a disaster. You know, because for the Berlin Biennial, I don't know if it's known, I think one of Fari's joints of the thing had disappeared. I'm not sure if it's Berlin or the last show, but one of those pieces of paper was gone in seconds. I mean, that's kind of cool too, but. I think it's very, what worries me about these conversations is when they try to sell it back to us. So in other words, when I come to visit these locations, people want to know, like, if I'm a good Kellogg raisin, am I a good decolonial? No, what the hell? You know, I mean, that's, no, it's not that I have no empathy for that institutional negotiation that's going on here. But, it's very dangerous when a victory has occurred within institutional spaces here, and then it's coming back to me through the British Council or something. You know? So there's a kind of a hegemonic power that comes back through because of the struggle within these contexts. And what is my relationship to those dynamics of power? Because a lot of these conversations have to do with a person who has something invested in the here, and they want to, they're seeking their due right to be here, and they want recognition from those institutions. And I kind of went through that when I lived in the US in the 80s as a student, in the height of the multicultural movement. Because in that period, I had to be something to be recognized. But yes, I'm black, but I'm not a black American, I didn't grow up in the US. So, how do I negotiate with their power structures? And that's an ongoing question. And then there's different kinds of blackness. In my context, blackness and whiteness is defined by one's relationship to capital. It's not a complexion or an ethnicity. It's basically one's relationship to an entitlement around capital and how we negotiate cultural space. So I don't, that's a different kind of way of understanding. I think it's similar here, but it has variations because, of course, when I arrive in these locations, I become black in a certain way. Like in the US, if I'm walking on the street and one clutches her hand up, or if I'm in England and right now, I'm on a residency in China, like what does my physical body mean in that space? It means something completely different. When I'm back in Britain, or years ago when I spent time in South Africa. So yeah, it's a really complex thing. But I think for me, the decolonial conversation really is, and I kind of want to understand it. It's like what people like Keane Copeland said 10 years ago. Like, what is the meaning of blackness in the expanded field? In the American context, and how it, what is blackness in Lagos or Hong Kong? It's kind of very complicated. I think that's something, that's an interesting debate, but I don't know if it obfuscates or clouds the struggle on the floor here. That's something you are to understand.
I'm just returning from yesterday's discussion about that.
Half the time. But, I would say, I was kind of fascinated by some of the comments I really heard during the YouTube. Yeah, I mean, okay, I'm 58 years old, right? So yeah, when I was in the States, yeah, I got mistaken for being a cleaner too, right? In my graduate department, when I was on fellowship. But I think there are other narratives. Like, for example, one of my first institutional jobs at Stony Brook, I would say hello and good morning to every cleaner, everybody I met, coming and going from the building. So I was telling Roshini a funny story where, yeah, my co-workers and colleagues sometimes would mistake me for one of the maintenance workers. But I had an advantage over them because of that. Because one day when my jaw got stuck, I went to the guy in the office next door and I said to him, hey, my jaw stick, I can't get it open. And he said, these people in the internet are so lazy, you know, they're from every world and they're just giving us trouble. I have a requisition form in for 3 months and I can't get my door hinge fixed. So the next day I come in. You see the old people I walk past. Hey, where are you going? I'm your son. Hey, by the way, you know, my desk drew a stick yesterday and I had to fill out a requisition form. I didn't fill out a requisition form. By lunchtime, I drew it. The guy still had his requisition form in. So there are dual systems, right? And I think that's another way of understanding the kind of duality we will be living. Because, yeah, I mistake me for clean, I don't care, but I can get my profits. Because I might have another problem at the institutional level. I actually left the US because of some of these problems, you know, because I was funded to be in a program and I started writing things. And they came to me and said, oh, we have money for you to do that. So the kind of areas into which you are going won't provide us with the rationale for funding we have. You know, so we need to kind of do something that will enrich is the word we're using our program. So then I realized they weren't really interested in me, they were interested in what my presence can do for the department if I sing a certain song. That's, you know, that's really tricky business. And it just got, I mean, I'm speaking very polemically, it's more complex than that, but it was kind of alienating. I just made a run for it. I said, let me go back in Caribbean and do my thing. But it's tough. It's a tough negotiation, and I envy anyone, you know, who has the gumption to take it on. You know, because I certainly couldn't. I made a run for it. I went back into English and tropics.